I want to bring you an amazing message, my friend, on an amazing topic. I'm calling this message, My Crystal Ball. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen in the future. Now, I won't be able to tell you precisely the timing. God keeps times in His own control. But I will tell you the substance of what is about to happen in our world. And it's my crystal ball. This is it. This is my crystal ball. I've studied it for 40 years. And I know a little bit about what's coming. Maybe the next 8 months, maybe 5 years, maybe 10, 15 years. I don't know the timing. But I do know what's coming. And I want to tell you that I'm going to address my remarks, first of all, to you leftists out there. You think you're so smart. I'm not telling you this to hurt you. I'm telling you this to help you. I'm going to tell you what's ahead in your future. You just go ahead and keep going. I'll guarantee you that you're going to face something you have no idea what you're getting into. So I'm going to direct it toward you leftists and what you're trying to do to our world. And then I'm also going to direct it toward you believers, because the vast majority of believers don't know what's going to happen either. Now, I have said already, when some people ask me about what this COVID-19 is doing, I have already said it is a trial run for the coming of the Antichrist. I'm going to prove that to you from the scriptures, and I'm going to show you what is ahead for us, in America even, and the world. But we want to particularly direct what's ahead for the leftists and what's ahead for the Christian. Of course, the final event of what's ahead for the Christian is the rapture of the believers, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, getting out of here. Hallelujah. But I want to show you what that's going to happen, how that's going to happen. I'm not going back into the dark. I have many messages on YouTube. You can go to rapture when, rapture how, rapture why. There's a lot of messages there. I'm not going to repeat that. I'm just going to give you an overview of what the Bible really says about the future for you Christians. But I want to also give it to you leftists. I hope you're going to listen to me. Now, you won't like what I say, but you should listen to what I say, because it'll save your skin. I'm telling you, it will save your skin. So if you ever listen to a preacher that you don't want to hear, you better listen to this guy, in Jesus' name. I'm bringing it on for you today. I'm bringing you a second installment of the message, My Crystal Ball. And I want to emphasize to you the fact that God has nothing against us knowing the future. He doesn't want us dabbling in spiritism and witchcraft. But in the book of Isaiah, for example, in chapter 7, if you want to read from verse 10 to verse 14, there's an incident where King Ahaz, troubled about two kings that were about to attack him. One was northern Israel, one was called Rezin, and the other one was the king of Syria. And he was out by the waterways preparing the water pipes that brought the water into the city of Jerusalem in case they were besieged. And God sent the prophet Isaiah out to him and said, you don't have to worry about what you're worrying about. He said, because what's going to happen is the two kings that you're concerned about today, he said, before this child, and this is where he gave the mighty scripture that's requoted in the New Testament, behold, a virgin shall conceive and be with child. And that what Isaiah said to him, and the meaning actually back there was Isaiah's wife was going to have a baby. And what Isaiah was telling King Ahaz was, he said, before this child is able to discern between good and evil, both of the kings that you're worried about will be dead. So you don't have anything to worry about. That's where the scripture comes in, Isaiah 7:14. But the Lord will still give you a proof. The prophet said to Ahaz, ask the Lord for a sign. And he said, oh, I won't tempt God with a sign. He said, no, God wants to give you a sign. I don't know. He said, I'll give you a sign anyhow. He said, this young woman is supposed to have a child. She will have a child. And before the child grows old enough to know between good and evil, both of the kings that you're worried about today will be dead. And here's the scripture. And of course, it has a second application in the New Testament because it refers to the Virgin Mary and the coming of Christ. In that case, he said, but the Lord will still give you proof. A virgin is pregnant and she will have a son and will name him Emmanuel. And he said, before this child grows up, the two kings you're worried about are both going to be dead. So you don't have anything to worry about. God's giving you a sign. Now, I'm committed to giving you the truth. And I've always done that. I've invited folks to challenge what I preach and teach according to the Word of God. And sometimes I have been challenged and I've had to change. It's always to be challenged against the proof of the Bible, the overall teaching of the Bible. You know, the future is fantastic, but the future for the people who are born again, children of God, is fantastically wonderful, beyond description. But the future for those who think they are religious and are not really truly born again Christians, or those who are just plain bad, they don't care if you know it, the future for them is so bad that there's no language that can possibly describe. And that's really part of what I was endeavoring to bring to you in this message. And of course, to show you from the Bible what it really says, you go to Revelation chapter 6, verse 15 in the CEV version. Here's what it says. The kings of the earth, its famous people, and its military leaders hide in caves or behind rocks on the mountains. They hide there together with the rich and the powerful and with all the slaves and free people, and they shout to the mountains and the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the one who sits on the throne and from the anger of the Lamb. That terrible day has come. God and the Lamb will show their anger, and who can face it? Friends, I said earlier, and I mean to try to reinforce it, that the future is so awful for people that won't follow Christ, that are full of deception and full of crime and full of illegal things. The future is so terrible. You people that are out there, if you're listening to me today and you're not a born-again Christian, but you're involved in the evils of this world, you have no idea what you're into. I'm trying to tell you to warn you ahead so you will escape from what you're going to face up in the future. But here the Bible plainly says in Revelation that it's going to be so bad that people would sooner die than face what they're going to face in the great judgment of the Lamb when he comes in Revelation chapter 6. And, I'm going to put in just a little clip here. I believe it's Parker that's singing. I never heard this song before, just very recently. And I want to just throw in this quick little clip because he sings about the wonderful thing that's ahead for the people of God. Just listen to this and rejoice if you're a Christian. But oh, take heart and take heed to the warning, my friend, if you're not. So, friends, let me talk just a moment about our president. President Donald J. Trump is God's last mercy on America. There's no coming back in 2024. There's no holding the Senate. It won't matter. All is lost. If DJT is lost, all is lost. I have no prophetic utterance. I just have the Bible. And I will tell you what the Bible says, and we need to take heed to it. So remember, when I read the scriptures or quote the scriptures, it's not me. It's God talking. If you'd like to censor it, go on up there and censor him. Good luck with that. Isaiah 10:6 says, against a godless nation I send him, against the people of my wrath I command him to take spoil and seize plunder, and to tread them down like the mire of the streets. Now this is God saying, I'm going to send an enemy upon your nation. That's what he says, and that's the setting of that verse in Isaiah chapter 10. Now, I know this is about God sending an evil general and an evil king to punish Israel. And the setting is not quite, it's not Trump, but it's close. Genesis 6:5, God says this, the Lord saw how evil humans had become on the earth. All day long, their deepest thoughts were nothing but evil. inventing evil things and evil ways. And in verse 11, the Bible says, God, the world was corrupt in God's sight and full of violence. Hello? Does that kind of ring a bell by our present time? And then Matthew 24:37 says, when the Son of Man comes again, it will be exactly like the days of Noah. Exactly like the days of Noah. So, it says, violence filled the earth. I want to ask you a question. Have you ever known any time in American history when in a supposedly civil society, a non-war state, we have violence filling the streets of our cities, burning and looting and even killing and beating up and injuring policemen and other people, murders and so on, happening right in the streets of our city? Violence filled the earth in those days, and Jesus said, it's going to be exactly like that in the day when the Son of Man cometh. So that tells you we're getting close to the coming of the Lord. When have we ever known violence in the streets that is supported by a radical Marxist party? A radical, one of our parties, our political parties, supporting the Marxist revolution and riots and killing and burning and looting in the street, playing it down, supporting them, even getting them out of jail when they're arrested. And that's our government. That's where we are. That's our justice system. That's our mayors. That's our governors. Not all of them, but the ones where this is happening. Governors and mayors should have been taken away in handcuffs when this was happening in their cities because they violated their oath of office. When they took the oath of office to be a mayor or to be a governor, they swore under God. I think mostly put their hand on the Bible and swore that they would fulfill the office, support the Constitution, and defend the people. And they completely disregarded the oath they took. They should have been put in handcuffs. I'm talking about the mayors and the governors should have been put in handcuffs and put behind bars. That's why we have the problems and the injustice and the corruptions we have, because we haven't punished people when they did it. And so they did more and they did more. And Jesus said, it's going to get so bad that it'll be like the days of Noah when God in heaven couldn't tolerate it any longer himself. Once more, I want to tell you that I do believe our president is the last hope for America. Now, it's possible that if he continues, he will be a terror. He will bring terror to the hearts of those that have created terror. That's my prediction. He is the rioter's regret. And of course, if he doesn't have control, we will see the violence continue and corruption capitalized. Violence and corruption fill America. She will be judged. Maybe Trump can hold back the avalanche of disaster. He is the last hope, and I will be surprised if he is not the last Republican president ever. Now, my message, of course, primarily is to decent people. And so I'm going to talk primarily right now to Republican people who are not on the ball. And you need to get on the ball. Some of you think, oh, well, it's going to be all right. We'll go ahead and things will get better after a while. No, no, no. This is your last chance. If you don't get on the ball now, you crazy Republican. Now, not all Republicans are crazy. Some of them are great people. But there's some of you that are cracked in the head. You don't even know that this is your last chance. And then I want to speak to the Democrats. There's some good Democrats out there, and you don't know either that this is your last chance. I mean, this is my crystal ball. And what I'm telling you, I don't believe God's going to spare America forever. But I believe that God could spare it for a period of time if we do the right thing today. So I'm calling on Republicans to stand up, and I'm calling on decent Democrats to stand up. This is America's last stand. I'm not talking about a civil war and a great battle to bring America back. I'm talking about the end of America. And I'm not the only one saying it. You listen to many reporters, many news people, many who have opinions, and they're saying this is our last chance. This is our last chance. So my first prediction in my crystal ball is that now is the final hour of American history. Now, if we make the right decision, we can go a while, I'm not going to tell you that America's going to keep on going forever. Oh, thank God he's going to keep America strong, and we're going to go on and on. No, no, no. The day's coming. America's coming down, and I'll tell you why that's going to happen. But it doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. It doesn't have to happen this week. That's what I'm saying to you. That, my crystal ball, I'll say it again. I will be very surprised if we ever have another Republican president. So, take heed. How do I know some of these things? Well, number one, the scripture says plainly, Proverbs 14, 34, righteousness exalteth a nation. You cannot by any stretch of imagination call what has been happening in our streets and in our voting booths righteousness. Righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. In another translation, it says, doing right brings honor to a nation, but sin brings disgrace. That's God's word. He said it. I'm just repeating it. The second thing that lets me know that we're headed for trouble, and it could be right now, because what I see shaping up in America is the perfect scenario. I've looked at the situation through the biblical eyes of prediction and prophecy for years, and I've said America is going to have trouble. I saw it. Years ago, I don't know how many, 20 years ago. But I envisioned what I thought would be the last day of America's stand. And what I see happening today is what I saw 20 years ago in the light of Scripture. But let me give you the other reason why I say that this is the end for America, or it could stall a little longer. America is not going to be well forever. And here's the reason why. Doing right brings honor to a nation, but sin brings disgrace. Now, there's a great war in Ezekiel 38 and 39 to take place in Israel. And I think that war is going to come quite soon. Some people think it's way out there in the distant future. Even Hal Lindsey, his prophetic outlook is very different from mine, but on this one point, I agree with him. He said he thought that this Ezekiel war, or at least part of it, was going to take place very soon, and it was the victory that Israel will gain in the Ezekiel war will be the thing that turns Israel back to God to rebuild her temple, which has to be done in the end time. Prophetic teaching hangs on there being a temple in Jerusalem. It's not there because a large percentage of the Jewish people are agnostics. They're not even sure that God is alive. But when they see the victory, now here's the point you have to look at carefully. If you read those prophecies, Ezekiel 38 and 39, you'll find one strange thing. You'll find that Israel is faced with the greatest number of people from all over the, the Muslim world and maybe even others are coming down to fight Israel with massive amounts of soldiers. And the Bible says that God is going to rain terror upon the enemies of Israel, and God is going to deliver Israel from the attack. Here's the point. This attack could not take place today because the nations of the world know that if they came down to annihilate Israel, America would stand up and fight. But in Ezekiel 38 and 39, America does not deliver Israel. God says, I'm going to do it. The nations will know that I'm doing it. Israel will know that I did it. America is not going to do it. And my question is, why? And the only possible answer that I can come up with is America's gone. America is in such confusion, such economic distress, such anti-Israel feeling like we see rising up today, especially in one of our parties, that America will not defend Israel from being annihilated by the anger of those who are led by satanic forces. They think it's God leading them, but Satan. And America's not going to defend Israel. And my question has been for 20, 30 years, why is America not defending Israel in the Ezekiel war? And the answer is America can't, possibly won't, possibly a combination of the two. America will not and perhaps cannot defend Israel. because she hasn't got the will to fight. There's such confusion and economic distress and collapse in America, and that's what we're facing in 2021. As government begins to proceed with what looks like we are heading to the precipice, to the end. There is no good news for America except Donald J. Trump. Mark my words. If I am not correct, a few months or years from now will show that I'm incorrect. But I'll tell you that I've studied the Word of God for a lot of years, and I believe this is what's in the future. This is my crystal ball. We have one chance, and that's in one man, our president, to hold back this tide, not forever, but for a while. So this is our golden day. And I want to tell you that Republicans and caring Democrats, you ought to take a good size hat pin and push it in your rear and get your ink to realize this is America's last day. If you do the right thing, we can go on a while. But if you don't do the right thing, 6 months, 2 years from now, you will look back and say, I wish to God I'd done something different in the beginning of 2021 and these amazing years that are coming upon us. Now, I'm going to leave that part of my crystal ball, and I want to go on to something else just to think about, and I need to do this. What about November? Let's look back at that for just a moment. And I want to bring you again some serious, sobering thoughts about what has been happening over just the few months past. Let's talk about November. There's one way that we can get to the bottom of all the things that have happened. And since our legal system has forsaken us, then there's one way we could do this. There is an election going on in Georgia, and what we could do is we could print up about 5 million ballots just off of a printing press and, have the printing press already click in all the votes for the two Republicans that are running, and just put those 5 million votes through and just have them all counted. And, of course, if the Dems have any problem with that, we can always say, well, you know, that's the way you did it, so we thought that's the way to do the elections now. That would really get to the bottom of it, but of course the problem is the Republican Party cannot do that. There's too many people who are God-fearing and who endeavor to be honest that that couldn't happen. But since this may be the last sermon I will ever preach in a free America, we could look at a couple of things. The Bible says specifically, Proverbs 14:34, righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Another version says, doing right brings honor to a nation, but sin brings disgrace. Then here is the ninth verse of the same chapter. Fools don't care if they're wrong, but God is pleased when people do right. And then verse 2, same chapter. By living right, you show that you respect the Lord. By being deceitful, you show that you despise Him. You despise the Lord. And then verse 25, an honest witness can save your life. Now, these are all verses that tell us where we are in such horrible conditions here in America. And so, you know, it's hard to get people to understand. I just saw a little piece. I think it was John Yoo who was, the assistant deputy attorney general at one time in the United States. So he sort of knows a little bit about the law. And he says things were really bad. Let's see if I can get that quote. I have it over here, what they were talking about. He and Peter Robinson. Oh, yes, I know now what he said. He said they have evidence that 17,650 Trump votes were removed in Georgia. I believe he's talking about Georgia. Now, you know, you've got to understand something, that if these voting machines had a setting on them where you could take votes off, that means they were set up to cheat. Because there's no way, once you have votes, if you're running as a candidate and you have votes, there's no way you can take votes off. It's like, think with me for a minute. It's like filling a glass with water. So you have the pitcher of water, you fill it up, it's quarter full. You fill a little bit more, it's half full. You fill a little bit more, it's three quarters full. And then you fill a little bit more, it's only a quarter full. How do you fill the glass and get it to go down? You can't. As you fill the glass, there's no way for it to go into the negative. And so if there was any possibility of votes going to the negative, that means the whole system was set up to cheat. Anyhow, these are a few things you need to know. Bobby Pittman is the one I would like you to go to on YouTube. Bobby Pittman, he has a lot of videos out there, and he'll tell you some things that happened. He says that if an elected official of a swing in swing states, if he were an elected official in swing states or an official of a company, he would resign rather than verify the votes, because he said he would have fear of going to jail for officially verifying something that he knew to be a fraud. Now, here is the plus thing about these elections, and I'm talking primarily here about Pennsylvania, something you need to know. 202,377 more votes than voters. What they did is they counted up the votes that came in from all of the precincts, from all of the counties. And they found out that the state vote had 202,377 votes more than the counties could verify. In other words, they just added a quarter million votes to the total. The counties didn't have them. The votes didn't come in, but they just added them. And that's one thing to look at. And then another thing is 31,547 votes were not counted. I'm talking about Pennsylvania now. Just a couple little things you should look up. Bobby Pittman will help you out here. Go to him on YouTube. I'm just relaying the information and suggesting you just look him up. That's easy to find. Bobby Pittman, P-I-T-O-N. Look him up. He's got a lot of videos on YouTube, and he will tell you these facts. You need to look them up today. You shouldn't go to bed tonight without looking them up. And if you are one of the cheaters and one of the defrauders, then you should be afraid to go to bed tonight. Because in the Bible, God smote dead two people that lied. He didn't give them a second chance. And if I were one of you people, or even some of the people in the legal system that have just closed their eyes to justice, I'd be afraid to go to sleep tonight. Because it just could be that God might show up again and say, hey, liars are going to have their last day. And you could go to bed tonight and not wake up tomorrow morning. That could happen all across the land. It has happened before. And I'd be afraid. I wouldn't be afraid of the government. I wouldn't be afraid of the law. I wouldn't be afraid, not even the Supreme Court, because they're mostly useless. But I would be afraid of the God of heaven, who is the judge of all. And I would have trouble getting my eyes closed and going to sleep tonight if I were in the shoes of some of you people out there. But anyhow, let's go on with what happened. Primarily in Pennsylvania, we're talking, but it happened. Similar things happened all across these swing states. But there were 31,547 votes that weren't counted. On November the 4th, 958,044 voters vanished. Did you know that? There were almost a million voters in Pennsylvania that just evaporated. They were there on the 3rd, and they evaporated on the 4th. There's no trace of them. They're not found in Pennsylvania. They can't find them anywhere. They just evaporated. It wasn't the rapture. They just evaporated. Imagine up to anywhere from about 600,000 to 900 and 58,044 voters in Pennsylvania evaporated. They just evaporated. They were there to vote, and now they're disappeared. They're nowhere found in America. 250,000 voters in Pennsylvania were orphans. They checked out. They have no mother, no father, no sisters, no brothers, no cousins, no uncles, no nothing. There were total, a quarter million voters have absolutely no relatives alive on the earth. Isn't that amazing? There's very few people that have nobody. I mean, there's some people that have been put in an orphanage or left behind. Their family has given them up for either adoption or just forsaken them. But to find that they have no mother, no father, no cousins, they just evaporated. They just absolutely have no relationship to anybody alive. And, of course, these irregularities add up to an amazing, amazing difference in the total. The estimate is that the very minimum, our president won 60% of the vote in perhaps universally and also in the swing states. So these are just a few things. And once again, I tell you, go look up Bobby Pittman, P-I-T-O-N, and you will find some amazing, interesting facts about what has been happening in the last couple of months. So, I opened up my computer, and I don't like what I see when I open it up and see some of these news people throwing stuff down at us. But I read the little piece. I hardly ever do, but I read the little piece. And, of course, it said that there's absolutely no cheating. There's been no cheating whatsoever. It's absolutely kosher, 100% honest and fair and open. And yet all these facts exist. It's like there's two worlds, one the world of reality and one the world of fantasy. And we have people living in the fantasy world. They won't live. They won't even believe the Bible. They say if we don't see it, proved, scientific method, right in front of our faces, we won't believe it. But when it comes to some of these other things, they'll believe anything. They would swallow a whale and call it a sardine if they could. Now, just to give you a little homespun kind of idea, let me spin a parable for you. Now, this isn't true, but it sometimes helps us to have a story to kind of relate to. Let us suppose that we have a kid, a young kid, and his father is the head of race car racing. He's way up there at the top. And the little kid is into building go-karts. And so the little kid says to his father, "Hey, Dad, could I enter my go-kart in the Indy 500? "Oh, his dad, "Yeah, Dad," he said, "I'd like to." And so, you know, to humor him, the father says, "Okay, guy." So he has a little go-kart he's been working on. He builds it from scrap pieces of plywood. And he gets four hubcaps, old hubcaps, and puts on that for wheels. And, you know, after a bit of getting somebody, trying to talk somebody into pushing him around the sidewalk in the go-kart, he finally hooks up. He gets a motor out of a hairdryer, and he rigs up a transformer, and he puts some flashlight batteries in there, and he actually gets enough power that he can actually move the little old go-kart along the sidewalk by its own power. And so he says, "Dad, I want to enter. I want to enter in the Indy 500. So the dad says, "Okay, you can get it over there on a sidetrack." So he puts the little go-kart over there on the sidetrack. And when the gun goes off for the race to start, why, he starts up the sidetrack. And, of course, the crowd cheers. They think it's so neat and so fun that the head of the race car racing has allowed his son to pretend he's in the race and race along one of the sidetracks. But to their amazement, the little old go-kart begins to pick up speed. And to everybody's amazement, he pulls right on out into the main track. And he accelerates. And in no time, the little kid's going 100 miles an hour around the track, and it keeps accelerating. He's going now close to 200 miles an hour, whatever speed it is they're running. And then he pulls up alongside of the actual race cars. And he gradually begins to pass them. 1, 2, 3, 4. And finally, he's pulling up right alongside of the lead racer in the Indy 500. And the people can't believe it. They're sitting there in the bleachers with their mouths wide open. And they can't believe this little go-kart is just steaming around that race. And he just keeps going round and round and round. He's right up there with the lead car. And as they come around for the final round, the little old go-kart gives a spurt of speed, and he pulls out ahead, and he comes in, and he wins the Indy 500 in a little plywood go-kart. Now, if you believe that story, then you can believe that the November election was clear and fair and transparent and totally honest. You can believe both of those things. Now, I want to talk about something else. What about our Constitution? Well, we have two books that are ultimately important to us. We have the Bible and we have the Constitution. And contrary to what some of the propagandists are saying, our president has been a strong advocate for our Constitution, And they're telling us, oh no, he's ready to destroy America's democracy. He's ready to destroy the Constitution. And of course, that is one of the big lies. And those two books stand, the Bible and the Constitution. And I've long said that as long as we follow our Constitution, America will do fairly well. But I see in the end time, what's going to happen is we're going to shred our Constitution and go make up some field rules as we go. We'll change the goalposts and we'll change the rules as we go. And whenever it's convenient for the left side to change a rule for its own advantage, they'll change the rules. And so we'll change all the rules till America is nothing but the shell of a nation. And I believe it's going to come to that. Unless, of course, we have a great revival of faith in the Constitution. We violate both the church and the Bible. And, you know, these things are... I'm just going to give you the Bible conclusion. Why will America come down? And there are two verses. I'm going to give them to you. And I'm going to be very presumptuous and very bold to read the verses. These are verses right out of the Bible. And so there should be no problem with reading them. But one verse, in fact, they're both found in Leviticus 18:21 is one verse and 22 is the other. And these are two verses that would indicate that America is in deep trouble. And if you look at these verses, what God says, then you know that we cannot continue in the vein that we're in now. Verse 21 says never. And that means not even one time. Give your children as sacrifices to the god Moloch by burning them alive. If you do, you are dishonoring the name of your God. And God says, who said this? God said, I am the Lord. I am Jehovah, and I say this. The second verse is 22. I won't repeat it. You can look them up. Leviticus 18:22. Never, that means not one time, have sexual intercourse with a man as with a woman. It's disgusting. And this is the God's Word translation, so I just leave that with you, and that's the problem we face. Now, what about the lockdowns? Let's talk just a moment about that. Again, I encourage you to look up what's called the Great Barrington Declaration. And in the Barrington Declaration, they looked at lockups, and we had 4,654 experts. They look at all the data. They are trained scientists and doctors and medical personnel. And 4,654 of these experts looked at the lockdowns and said they are not a good idea. They cause the virus to spread. In fact, we know that 74% of people who come down with COVID get it at home. Only about 1.4% get it in restaurants. So we close the restaurants and put people in home. Why? So that they can die. That's what we're doing. We're following the agenda of death. Anyhow, beside the 4,000, there's another 8,681 who were practicing doctors and nurses and medical people. They also said lockdowns are a bad idea. And then we have other medically concerned people. They may not be trained as doctors or nurses, but 121,000 and 81 of them signed on to say that lockdowns are a dangerous procedure. And so what are we doing in America? We're doing lockdowns because we're following the avenue of death. So just a word about COVID. This is the way to kill people. And that's the process we are following in many of the lockdown states. We're following the process. We have the vaccine. It'll be out in a it'll be pretty well out and around in the next few months or half a year. And as that works, of course, we'll eventually cut down on this terrible plague. But in the meantime, we have lost our heads and we should try to get them back. Now, the final thought that I have for you today, and I'm going to refer you to the first part of this message, My Crystal Ball. But I want to talk about the rapture, because that's the escape for the people of God. And that's the great hope that we have. The rapture is coming very soon, probably in the next few years. I'm talking about 10 years. I'm talking about 6 years. I'm talking about maybe 15 years. But it's coming very, very soon. And I don't need to repeat what I gave you, but I gave three expert scriptures. They're scriptures that I think stand by themselves that prove that we're going to face the wrath of man under the Antichrist, but we're going to get out of here when the wrath of God falls on the left. So you people on the left, you know there's something coming for you, and it's big and bad. It's so bad that people say, I would sooner be dead than face what I've got to face. But you're going to have to face it. God's going to say, no, you can't die. You've got to face the punishment for what you're doing today and the crookedness that you're doing. If you don't go to bed tonight and die in your sleep, which would be a great mercy, you will face the terrible judgment of God that's about to happen, and it's going to fall on America and the world. But I don't need to repeat those scriptures again, because I think I did a good job of it on the first part. So if you go back to my crystal ball, A, first part, and if you want to just get right to the scriptures, then fast forward through to about minute 27. It's the kind of the last third of the message, and there I outline the three primary scriptural portions that show you that what I have predicted in my oval or in my crystal ball, what I've predicted from the scriptures, these things are clearly spelled out in the scriptures. You may not have seen it before, but you need to look again. And I'm going to put up here for you the icon of the first part, my crystal ball, part A. I'll put up the icon. It's easier to find it in the midst of all my messages. If you see the icon, it's the one that has the Quaker oat package in the background on a little table and a bowl of porridge. And you can find it easily by that. Roll ahead to about minute 27, and there you'll get the three scriptures. I don't want to give them again. Instead, what I want to do is end out this message with some songs from Gordon Jensen. Now, Gordon Jensen is one of America's great songwriters. He's written dozens and dozens and maybe hundreds of Christian songs. Gordon Jensen was my guest when I was pastoring a larger church, and we put him on our television show. And then one day we were singing in our church here in Lakewood. We were singing Bigger Than Any Mountain, I think was the song. And one of the ladies, one of the families in the church they were so blessed. They loved that song. And we got talking after church, and they said, oh, we would love to hear Gordon Jensen in person. Well, you know, my wife went ahead and contacted him through his website, and it so happened that a month or so after that happened, he was coming through this area of the country for some event. And he said, yes, I would come. Now, we're a small church, but he said, yes, I would come. So we tried to get the advertisement out. We knew that people all over Los Angeles and Southern California, probably more people than we could put in our building, would want to hear Gordon Jensen in person. So I contacted Christian TV because I had worked with them many years ago on a commercial. And I said, now we have a guest here coming through, and it would be wonderful if you could just put him on one of your talk shows or one of your news pieces and expose him a little bit, because he's a great Christian songwriter. And there's many people that sing his songs. When you look down through the list of his songs, you find many songs you've heard. Other performers sing his songs. And so I said, would you have some place to put him in? They said, no, we wouldn't. Well, I said, he's a very popular songwriter. You'd be blessed by having him on. No, we can't do that. And I said, you don't know who he is, do you? And the lady I was talking to at the Christian TV, if I remember right, she said something very awful to me. They'd probably fired her if they knew she said this. But she said, I don't care if he's Jesus Christ. We plan our program 2-3 months ahead, and there's just no way to put somebody on in short notice. Well, he didn't get on. We had a crowd, not a real good crowd, but we had a crowd to hear him. And I want to give you a couple of his songs, because his songs, Bigger Than Any Mountain. God is bigger than any mountain. All the bad stuff that we're talking about, God's bigger than that. And then he sings another one, Redemption Draweth Nigh. And I want to tell you, that's the hope of the Christian. Look up, because redemption draweth nigh. There may be hardships to go through for a while, but look up, we're getting out of here. And the people that aren't getting out, they're the ones in deep trouble. But I'm telling you today, friend, if you're on the left, you need to switch over and get on the right. You might not wake up tomorrow morning if you stay on the left. And if you do stay on the left, you're going to wish you did die tonight, because what's going to happen to you is worse than any words can express. It's the most horrible time that mankind has ever known on the earth since the beginning of time. And the Bible says it's worse than anything that's ever happened before. And it's so bad that it's never going to happen again. And that it's going to be torture. It's going to be, and it's going to last for 3.5 years. It's going to be terrible. So you need to switch sides. Get over on God's side. Call me. We put up our website every time. You can get on the phone. Call me. Make contact. We'll pray with you. We'll help you. We'll get you into Bible studies. We'll get you through to God. That's my message for you today, and I'm going to turn it over to Gordon Jensen now as we bring in a few clips of his singing to cheer you and lift you up. Lift you up if you're a Christian, and let you walk with God in the power and the strength of faith and liberty and peace and hope. In Jesus' name.
Bigger than all my problems, bigger than all my fears. God is bigger than any mountain that I can or cannot see. Bigger than all my questions, bigger than anything. God is bigger than any mountain that I can or cannot see.
Another of Gordon Jensen's popular songs is Redemption Draweth Nigh. Be sure to go to his website and get some of this fantastic music.
Years of time have come and gone since I first heard it told how Jesus would come back again someday. And if by then it seems so real that I just can't help but feel how much closer is coming.